This week, we have been celebrating 25 years of a mammoth political event that took place in Ghana. It was a protest march and it was organized by politicians. It was organized against this president, Flight Lieutenant Rawlings.
Policies that the government has been implementing are policies that do not find favor with the general mass of our people, and that the mass of the people of this country have been systematically impoverished during the period of Rawlings' rule. It is not a point of view that has found very much favor in the parts of the world from where you come from.
The demonstrations were organized about economics, taxes, and the livelihood of Ghanaians.
We knew that the first half of this year would be difficult for the point of view of inflation. And then last year's harvest, food harvest, was the worst we've had since about 1983. So the harvest was so lean that we knew that come this first quarter of the year, there will be problems with food prices.
The protesters, numbering over 100,000, marooned all over Accra on that fateful day in May 1995. They broke the rules. Some of them were shot, and some of them were shot dead. Those who died were buried. 25 years later, one of the leaders of the demonstration has become the president of Ghana. And on the 25th anniversary, he hosted some of the leaders of the demonstration at the seat of government. But over time, relationships have been affected. Some of their relationships have become better, some have become bad. Dr. Nyaho Tamaklu, for instance, is now against Nana Akufo-Addo. Kweku Baku Jr. and Kwesi Pratt Jr. were tightest of buddies. Today, they are only civil to each other. And only one of the leaders of the Kumipreku March made it into the government of Nana Akufo-Addo. His name is Victor Newman. He is the director of research at the office of the president. However, editor Kweku Baku Jr. and President Akufo-Addo are still tightest of buddies. So, what is the Kumipreku story? And who can tell it better than comrade Kwesi Pratt Jr.?
When panel members of the tribunal themselves have publicly admitted that the state government interference in the affairs of the tribunal, you know very well the case of Dr. Kumi versus Akintayo. You know the allegations that your colleague made about Akintayo's interference in the affairs of the tribunal.
One of the big questions to ask is, how did they organize such a mammoth event without mobile phones, without Facebook, without Twitter, and without Instagram? So, are there any lessons to learn from Kumipreku? Is Kumipreku possible again today? The factors that made Kumipreku possible in 1995, do we still see those factors around us in Ghana today? Or was the whole demonstration, protest march exercise a selfish ambition towards personal aggrandizement? So that's your exclusive interview tonight on Good Evening Ghana with Kwesi Pratt Jr. Kumipreku 1995, 2005, 2015, and 2020. And of course, we'll talk about the matter of credible elections in Ghana and the desire for a new voters register. That's Good Evening Ghana tonight on Metro TV. Okay, so do get ready for that interview. Good evening and welcome to this edition of Good Evening Ghana. There's a live interview coming up. Two live interviews, actually. That's the latter one. The second one is with Kwesi Pratt Jr. about 25 years of Kumipreku. We'll be asking him all kinds of questions and looking at Ghana today and Ghana then. And then, of course, we'll talk about the much-vexed issue now of the voters register. He has seen so many elections in Ghana. He has seen 1992. 96, 2000, 2004, and up until this time. We'll be asking him what his views are on the current controversy about whether or not to have a voters register, and if we do, and if we must have it, whether the old voters register must be one of the breeder documents. That is the documents that will be applied to determine whether people are qualified to be on the new register. That's coming up with Kwesi Pratt. But we know that COVID-19 has come and changed our lives, and for some people it's changing for the worse. We'll be talking to Grammy Awards nominee, the pride of Ghana, Rocky Dawuni, in the first part of the program. Rocky Dawuni has launched an album, and we'll be playing you some of the songs in the album. He'll tell us why he chose the theme of the album to be what it is. So I'll keep that from you when he comes on set and he's in the studio. He'll be telling us about that. Whilst we get Rocky Dawuni in ahead of Chrissy Pratt's interview, let's listen to one of the tracks, which is my favorite on Rocky Dawuni's new album. It's called Champion Arise.
Spiritual warfare.
Welcome back to the show. You like that? Champion Arise, we shall win. Let the spiritual war begin. Good evening, Rocky Dawuni.
Good evening.
Good to see you. It's good to see you. It's a pleasure to see you. So you are in Ghana. Yes. So you've been in Ghana since we closed the airport?
Yes. I came, I think a month before. Mm-hmm. So I had traveled. I was on a trip to the Middle East, which was a combination of various spiritual leaders and cultural leaders. We were there for an initiative on the Jordan River. Mm-hmm. And so we were in Jordan, Palestine, Israel. And by the time we left on our way, that was when everything started happening around the world. Wuhan was going on, you know. So from the airports, we started seeing, you know, all the tension and stress. So I came down to Ghana in that time too. I came early because my mom's funeral, we were preparing for my mom's funeral. Mm-hmm. My mom had passed on in October. So I came like to have 1 month at least ahead of things. And then as you were here preparing, you know, everybody started shutting down. So I couldn't leave for anywhere. I had a concert coming. Everything started getting canceled. Ghana was canceled. So I just stayed
on. So you've been here since March?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Yeah, this is the longest you've stayed in Ghana in 10 years, I think.
Actually, earlier than that. I've stayed here, you know, but it feels long. Mm, it feels long. But at the same time, too, I think that, you know, situations like this, what it allows you to do, it allows you to really, you know, peel, because you don't have anything else. Everything is canceled, so your schedules are all clean. Mm-hmm. So now you start focusing on things locally. So I've been using the time to work on, you know, my farms, and, you know, I'm heavily into agriculture, so I love, you know, to spend those times doing that, you know.
Which part of Ghana is your agriculture business?
I have a cocoa farm in Samai.
Cocoa?
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Yeah, I have a cocoa farm in Samai. I also have farms in Koforidua. I'm working on a coconut farm right now.
Oh, wow.
So the last 2 days were like in planted mode, you know, planted up in the Botebri Mountains in the back.
I see.
You know, and
where did you film this song that we were just watching?
I filmed this. So this was an interesting project. So first of all, I had come to Ghana as part of, I had done some work for Cadbury, actually, Mondelez, a few years back. That has to do with cocoa farms, you know, bringing bicycles into cocoa farms and helping, you know, the children of cocoa farmers in terms of access to schools and girls being able to, you know, cutting time in terms of mobility within cocoa areas. Mm-hmm. So I had worked on this project. And then when we celebrated the anniversary of it, I did a piece with NPR, which is National Public Radio. You know, it's a global network. BBC gets its feeds from them and all that. So NPR did a piece on my work on that initiative. So Mondelez decided to fly me and a whole lot of other filmmakers to come and do a 360 video in some of the cocoa villages to see how impact of this bicycle program has happened. So we came with, you know, a big crew of people with some of the best cameras, you know, here. So at that time too,
maybe they should roll that. They should roll the tape without a sound, and then we can talk about it.
At that time too, I had, you know, something that I think now is becoming a public knowledge. You know, I had taken possession of the.
So what? Where is this?
This is the former Rita Marley Studios in Eburi.
Ah, on the mountain.
On the mountain.
Okay. So what's the symbolic gesture of opening undoing the padlock and getting in?
Well, the whole thing is the champion arise. You know, the whole concept of the video, it's about.
Oh, that's part of the building?
Yeah, that's a part of when it burned down. You know?
Ah, yes. You know,
when it was finished, after it was completed, it was a vision of that Bob had, and Rita came and built it over years. And then when it was ready to go live, a fire. Yeah. You know, happened, and then 7 years ago, it burned the whole place down. You know, so years ago, I've been friends with the family for a long time. So years ago, the opportunity came for me to now take it over and rebuild it.
And, okay, so you now own it?
Yes, I do.
Okay, congratulations.
Thank you.
I mean, that's a piece of heritage.
Yes.
I mean, something Bob Marley knew about.
Yes.
That's a piece of heritage.
And so the concept of Champion Arise was also going through adversity and problems and also tragedy and coming out of it. So that's why some of the shots, you know, you see the shots are focused, first of all, in this dilapidated building.
So this is the same place?
This is California.
This is California?
This is California.
Looks very much like Ghana.
Yeah.
Oh, you're serious?
Yeah, and then some of the shots too in California too.
Is it Los Angeles?
Los Angeles, Malibu Coast.
I see.
And then we also shot it right close to one of the...
So this is California?
This is California right here.
Oh, wow.
But there's parts that you see me also visually holding at a studio. That studio too is one of the most iconic studios where Lady Gaga, Lady Gaga, U2, a whole lot of other people recording that studio. And that studio was just during the California fire. Some of the property was burned in that studio. So the guy who owns it is a good friend of mine. I've done some recordings over there. So I did the two right here.
Oh, this is California.
This is California.
Oh, okay.
So you see that, you know, it also has wood inside
that
looks like.
Look, that very inside similar.
Yeah, no, this one right here.
Hold it right there.
Hold it right there. Yeah. This is back in Ghana.
Yeah.
So these were all both.
Yeah, hold displays. It here. Yeah. Okay. Excellent.
So this was a studio, Woodshed Studios. It's world famous.
I see.
One of the most amazing studios in the world. You know, great sound, incredible space. So I use the two as a metaphor for going through something, fire and kind of renewal and rebirth. You know, and also at that time when I was writing this song and filming this, you know, we weren't in the situation in which we are right now. But it was a song about going through tragedy and coming to, and using that tragedy as a means to strengthen yourself and come out with a very, come out grounded and also ready to utilize your inner strength to confront whatever situation and then be victorious.
Now you were prophetic about COVID-19. You're really prophetic.
Well, you know, the thing is that I think the word prophetic is these days thrown around a lot.
I think
it was more insightful.
Mm-hmm.
Insightful that because of my work too with the UN, I had been working a lot in the climate space,
And climate change space.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then in terms of the importance of all of us recognizing the issue at hand and trying to garner both, you know, public and private support, governments, you know, NGOs, you know, people to also take responsibility for themselves, that this is a problem that it's not going to be some government or some UN organization that is going to solve for you. This is something that nature itself, from our dealings with nature in terms of, you know, our fast rise to, you know, march to progress without seeing how much the rise to progress is impacting the environment. Cutting trees, polluting waters, you know, drinking, you know, vulnerable drinking water, then, you know, we see that being polluted just for gold, you know, which obviously you can't drink and you can't eat in the long run. So water is more valuable than the gold. Like we, you know, so all these priorities are misplaced. But then I knew that at some point nature too will hit back, because we can't keep, it can't hold. You know, the business as usual would not hold. So at some point, we're going to be seeing all these issues around nature, and we just needed to prepare and change the mindset of people to be able to do that. So even diseases were part of the whole change in climate, because we knew that when we lose our biodiversity and also the temperature in the air increases, and we have issues with sanitation, all of that, we just open ourselves to diseases that probably we have not even encountered in years. And that's like cutting forests, all these come. And we are not prepared and increased our immunity enough to be able to confront these things. So what we are confronting right now is probably the first shot from nature. It's going to be the first one. But I feel that if we don't change our ways
of destroying the environment.
Of destroying the environment. Mm. This is just the first part of confronting many, 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 many crises along the way. So maybe this is an opportunity for us to utilize that, to shift the mindset and start preparing ourselves to be more proactive towards, you know, preserving our environment, preserving our land. You know, because we're talking about security, you know, and obviously water, you know, our water resources, we outsource some of them to other entities that are not us, you know. So all those are security issues that we have to look at. You can't sell water, you know. Water is more valuable than, in the long run, when your gold and this thing is gone, you can't use your gold to go buy water, you know. So somebody controlling your water sources controls it being something that is invaluable, you know. So we just, and the trees, the biodiversity, because the future of medicine is all based on plants. And plants, even the medicines in history that are being used for everything right now, had their genesis from plants. So we also know that an area which has its biodiversity intact are also areas where you can find undiscovered, you know, treatments and cures for future diseases. So we have to make sure that all these natural repositories and laboratories that we have, we should be protecting them, because they, it could be, you know, what will be the game changer when we are confronted with something of this.
That's very interesting. That's very deep. That's what you mean by let the spiritual war begin.
Let the spiritual war begin.
So who's the champion here? Champion arise, we shall win.
Champion arise is all of us. It's you, it's me, it's everybody. So the whole thing is that, you know, a champion is somebody, you know, we see a champion as somebody who has assumed victory. And also a champion is somebody too who has a cause and stands behind the cause, so convinced of, you know, the righteousness of what they're doing, that they are willing to do everything that it takes for them to see victory. So what I'm saying is that this champion is everybody who is at home trying to figure out what's going on, everybody who has been impacted by this. Our economies have been ravaged. And, you know, 80% of our economies here is in the informal sector. You know, informal sector supports African economies other than the Western economies that the formal sector plays a major role. So the dynamics of our economic situation are totally different. So when we all do one thing, like we all do lockdowns, the impact is different. The impact is here. We have people who probably have $150, you know, as their running capital. And so when the lockdown is happens, by the next a few days or 1 week, they've spent their capital. And so, you know, they have to start back again. So all these, you know, so the dynamics of what we are facing is totally different. So our economic plan has to be focusing on how to strengthen that sector, which is 80% of what we do. If only we're
even
thinking
if,
about
even if in strengthening them, we are going to create a danger for the virus,
virus. No. I'm not saying that lockdown is bad. I'm just saying that the impact of the action, because every action is a reaction.
It doesn't mean we should understand that the impact is brutal.
The impact is severe, and we are not going to see the impact right now because we're still in it. You see, so we're still in it. So when we finish, it's only the 20% that drives African economies is going to be what is probably functioning. That's the formal sector. And the formal sector probably hasn't even survived too.
Well, the telecom sector, the IT sector is going to work too.
Yeah, but that is only a small
part. But we don't participate much in the IT sector.
We don't participate. Yeah. I'm talking of the everyday person.
I'm going to be talking to Kwesi Pratt soon. And he's one of the people who've talked about the tragedy of seeing the giant mobile telephone companies, all of them belonging to foreign companies other than Ghana.
I like the word tragedy.
Kwame Nkrumah was talking about this 100 years ago.
Yes.
60 years ago, he was talking about it. 60 years on, the picture, the outlook is worse than when Nkrumah talked about neocolonialism.
Yes.
And that's a big story we can deal with later.
Well, you know, the thing is that we have to look at telecommunication as controlling information in your country.
Yes.
And information, governance, everything is based on information.
Yes.
So if you don't control the source of your information, then, you know, you're shooting blanks in the dark, you know. So certain things, as I said, like water resources, you know, like forests.
I mean,
like
even though here in Ghana, where the leading telecom company has been listed on the Ghana Stock Exchange to allow Ghanaians to participate. So that's a kind of a
Well,
good
you
story.
Know, I mean, stock exchange is like monopoly money sometimes.
Yeah. But that's at least a step.
You own a concept of the company. But you don't really, you're not really a shareholder.
Yeah, but that's a step.
You know?
That's
step at least a way of, you know, letting people to participate.
Yeah.
But all I'm saying is that just because we can get money for something, we don't have to sell it, you know. And I don't. And I think there's a difference too between wealth and money, and that's what we need to know. That certain things like our land is wealth, so you can't sell land for paper money. Paper money is only ink, paper, and then a concept of relative value, and that value is determined by some market that we wake up and we are participants to. We don't determine it. So a lot of times when we are making all our economic predictions, you know, based upon those suppositions, you know, our economic things have to be tangible. It has to be on the farm. It has to be people, the youth being empowered, the youth being inspired, you know, the knowledge of, you know, not the usual, like, okay, the cash crop, the usual crops that we grow, but we should research like different kinds of crops that are grown in different parts of the world that can grow in our soil and can be valuable. I was just in Israel and I was totally, I mean, blown away by the agricultural sector there. Like, it is so developed, it is so kind of to the top. Everything they plant, it's like very, very, I mean, it's The amount of money that is generated there is immense, and it drives that economy. So why can't even the young people here now start being trained on new types of plants, greenhouse farming.
We're doing greenhouse.
You know,
in Ghana, we're doing a lot.
Yeah,
of
but
greenhouse.
I'm saying in terms of the knowledge being trained, not a few entrepreneurs starting it.
Yeah,
you know,
but it being part and parcel of our
part
education
and parcel
system.
Of our education, because now we're thinking of jobs. Now the only main job that we have is our land, agriculture, and agriculture is the basis of every economy everywhere. America,
from the
no
beginning,
matter,
they all started that
they
way.
They still
do agriculture.
Agriculture is still a big part of, but agriculture with value added.
Because agriculture is food.
It's food. So when you think of food.
And agriculture is clothing.
It's clothing. Yeah. Agriculture is, you know, also you think of energy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. These days, yes.
These days, you know, let's say, you know, you can use farm residue to create biogas. Mm-hmm. You can also drying. The drying itself is a whole business. Here, we don't even have a thriving drying business. But
what is a drying business?
Drying business means that whenever we, at the end of every farming season, the biggest problem is not that we don't produce enough. The biggest problem is that we don't preserve enough.
Okay.
We don't have the ability to preserve
it, to keep it for
much
the,
of the food.
For the rainy day.
For the rainy day. So drying is a key thing that you have to dry the foods. Mm-hmm. You know, fruits, you have to dry it. Mm-hmm. You know, tomatoes, you have to dry it. Like all these. So if you're able to dry all this, you can export them, you can add value to them, and it can create also, another economic aspect of agriculture where people, there can be entrepreneurs who can start drying businesses. And now, you know, we have solar, you know. So all these things, you know, is even part of the UN's vision too of the post-COVID economy because, mm-hmm. you know, interventions like, you know, solar economy, training young people to get into agriculture is all part of how we can also be able to reshore up the informal sector. But you know, you can't have economic development with only the informal sector. So the informal sector is a matter of elevating it to a certain level, but then maybe we use that as an opportunity to move and, you know, and push and train people more. Eventually, you know, there will be some great entrepreneurs that will come out of this whole thing who are also going to establish formal businesses. Yes.
I'd like to thank you. So what's your next plan as you remain in Ghana?
Well, now the video, you know, it just came out and it's really doing.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Yeah, it's doing really wonders all around the world because of the message, and then also the whole thing where it's about, you know, letting all of us know that, you know, it's going to be all right. You know, we didn't come all this way in human evolution for us to be, you know, knocked down by something that we can't even see. Mm-hmm. You know, but at the same time too, it is not that we have to just hide in our rooms and play on our computers all day and all of them watch TV and be bored and come and think that we'll come back to a world that is same way. The world has changed. The status quo has shifted. The paradigm has reorganized. You know, so people need to also start thinking of how do we elevate? How does Africa become self-reliant? How, because right now, most countries, what is going to happen is that everybody is going to be holding on to their food. Mm-hmm. So if we don't look and have reserves of food, and that, how are we going to be able to feed ourselves? Because food will be the most expensive thing. You know, so my thing is proactively also getting on the ground, farming, you know, taking care of my farms and all of that, and then also inspiring people, the youth, to get into farming and agriculture, and also appreciation of our land, you know, environmental awareness. I was actually planning to do a tree planting initiative with the mayor of Accra, which was supposed to start around this time.
The COVID came in.
Yeah, the COVID came. We're planning to plant 100,000 trees in Accra. And then I have a similar project too in the northern region. It was just about to start also 100,000 tree planting initiative over there. And I had done an announcement during the last UN General Assembly, a big announcement of all of that. It was supposed to start. But then, you know, man proposes, God disposes.
But we are all excited and very proud of what you're doing with the United Nations, Rocky Dawuni.
Thank you.
We'd like
much.
You to give us an a cappella of the chorus in Champion,
okay.
Champion Arise.
A champion arise, we shall win. A champion arise, we shall win. Whoa, 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 whoa. We're stronger and alive, we shall win. Let another spiritual war begin. They'll say it could not be done until they see it done. They'll say it could not be you until you know it's you, my friends. My friends, a champion arise, we shall win. Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank
everybody.
You, thank you. Yeah. Thank you. And we hope that you stay for the rest of the program and then we can have a chat. But please, after COVID, invite me to the Bury place. I'd like to see it.
I will definitely.
And when it's fully up and let's recommission it.
Yes. So, I mean, we, you know, there's just a lot of work to be done.
It looks like
burned,
that, yeah.
You know, is currently being rebuilt and all of that kind of stuff. So it will take, you know, a few years to.
But it will be beautiful.
It will be beautiful. And now it's fully a Ghanaian entity. So
absolutely.
It will be a place too for activism, music, culture. Mm. You know, studio. You know, inspiring young people. You know,
great.
We just all need to.
So it's going to be a city.
It's going to be
a city of ideas.
Yeah. It's going to be a hub of ideas.
A
hub of ideas. A cultural incubator.
Wow. Super. I like to be there.
Yes.
Okay. So after the break, Chrissy Pratt will join us in the studio. But what can we do with the break? Let's listen to it again. Champion Arise, We Shall Win. Let the Spiritual War Begin by Rocky Dawuni.
Be you until you know it's you, my friend. My friend, when the humble pop the bubble, they don't ever see it come. They tumble to the magic of the word and the sound forever. I believe now they come around and asking, tell them he's the children of Judah. Break a rubber chain and a ruler. Everybody's praying. Everybody say, yeah.
Champion arise, we shall win. A champion arise, we shall win. Whoa, we're stronger and alive, we shall
They tell me I'm just a whiskey, but I'm more than that. I'm a blend. Born from the finest single malts and grains, blended to be smooth with a warm amber glow. Admired by men and women all over the world. I'm not one of these things. I'm all of these things. Mellow, rich, and generous. Because blended is better in life and in Scotch. Chivas, blended Scotch whiskey.
Drink responsibly. Not for sale to persons under 18 years of age. Not recommended for pregnant women. This advertisement has been vetted and approved by the FDA.
There is 1 million excitement in the air, and Sapa just tapped into the mood with a share of Wesbin from the 1 million Wesbin project.
1 million Wesbin project?
It is a nationwide social intervention project aimed at helping improve the lives of people by correcting poor sanitation practices and improving solid waste collection service delivery in Ghana by providing 1 million radio frequency identity tag free waste bins.
Radio frequency identity tagged waste bins. This will enable monitoring of how often the waste bins are emptied in real time. Wow.
From your homes, offices, schools, hospitals, right through to places of worship. Yeji baby.
How and where do I sign on?
Our branded registration and distribution officials will come along with their ID cards to register and distribute waste bins to all households. Just provide them with your name, contact number, house number, and digital address. Once signed on, you'll be introduced to your zone's designated waste collection service provider who will collect your waste on agreed days of the week.
Wait, is it free?
Yes, of course. The waste bins are free. You would, however, be required to pay a token as a registration fee at the point of registration and a monthly subscription fee as communicated by your service provider. Payment for such services can be done through mobile cash payments, short code *887*87#, or through all Ecobank branches and payment platforms nationwide.
Oh my God, this is already getting exciting.
Yes, bro. With the 1 million waste bin project, you would enjoy improved solid waste collection, easy access to complaint services, quick response to complaint, easy and convenient means of payment.
What am I waiting for?
What are you waiting for? Get ready to grab your free share of waste bins now!
Welcome back to the show. Thank you very much for your time. And as part of the Rocky Dawuni interview, I forgot to mention my friend Daniel Dama, who says to tell Rocky that he's so, so proud of him. He says Rocky is their star. They come from the same hometown, I believe. Daniel Dama, if you are watching, good evening and good evening to your family. Rocky Dawuni has heard you. And he says, shout out to you right back. Good evening, Comrade Kwesi Pratt.
Hi, good evening, Paul.
How are you doing?
Well, we can't complain, can we?
How have you managed to keep such a youngish poster for so many years? I was looking at the Kwame Preko videos, and you have not changed even from then. I mean, I saw Nana Akufo-Addo, we showed his video, we showed it again, he's changed. Now, Tamaklo, all the guys, how come that you have not changed? What have you been doing?
Well, first of all, I don't know if I haven't changed.
No, you haven't. I'll put a photograph up now, people will see that you haven't. You look as young as... Yes, okay, so this is it. So Kwesi, tell us, who are in this photograph? Some we can easily identify, some we don't know. Who are these?
Well, I think everybody can be easily identified. I mean, mm-hmm. if you look at the guys who are sitting down, mm-hmm. from the left is my good friend Akutuan Pao.
Yeah.
And then there is His Excellency the President Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo. Mm-hmm. And Tarzan, Dr. Charles Rekubrobi.
Yeah.
There is Kweku Bakun Kakraba, now Abdul Malik Kweku Bakun. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo. Mm-hmm. And then from the back is Kweku Poku.
Oh, that's Kweku Poku. Okay.
Yeah, Kweku Poku. And
your good self.
Yeah.
And then
Kakraba Cromwell, who okay. I think used to be the president of the National Union of Ghana Students.
Yeah.
And Victor Newman, okay. who is now, I think, the head of research.
Yeah, the director of research.
At the Flagstaff House.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what occasion was this?
Well, I think that this must have been about after the first demonstration in Accra, the Kwame Preko demonstration. And after, you know, we had lost some of our people.
They were killed.
And others, yeah, they were killed in the demonstration. And we decided to organize a funeral for them. And somebody suggested that we needed to take this photograph. Indeed, that person turned out to be quite prophetic because the person said that this photograph will become part of our history. And so,
oh, I see.
And today I see this photograph being circulated everywhere. Hmm. So,
where did you take this photograph? Where?
This photograph was taken at the home of Dr. Charles Rekubrobi in his garden. You know.
Ah, I see.
So this was the home of Dr. Charles Rekubrobi. I think it was in North Ridge.
Yeah.
North Ridge.
Yeah. But why are you not in the black cloth?
Because I didn't have a black cloth.
You didn't have one?
I didn't have one.
So then the nearest you could get was something that has whitish in it for a funeral?
Well, it's dark, and for me it was sufficient, you know.
Mm, I see.
Besides, I'm not that traditional.
Okay.
If I had a black cloth, I would have worn it. This is all I had.
Are there some other people who were leaders of the demonstration who are not in this photograph?
Well, you know, it's about how we tell history. It's about how we relate to history. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, history is about the most known. History is about those who address press conferences and so on. Mm-hmm. And history tends to ignore the mass of people who really are the makers of history. Mm-hmm. So there are 9 of us in this photograph, but there were many thousands who participated in the event, who did many things, who contributed immensely to the success of our enterprise, who would never be known, who would never be mentioned, and who had no opportunity to be in photographs like this. There's one who is very, very significant, and I refer to my good friend Stanley Ejiri Blankson.
Stanley Blankson, the former mayor of Accra?
Yeah, who is now a member of the Council of State.
Yes.
The whole idea of forming that alliance and of organizing...
The Alliance for Change.
The Alliance for Change. Mm-hmm. And also of confronting the establishment at the time and so on, was actually nurtured in A.J. Blankson's house.
I see.
And yet, for some strange reason, he never became one of the nine. Eventually, when we expanded the group, we brought him in. But this whole idea started from the house of A.J. Blankson in Dansoma. I think it was Nana Akufo-Addo's birthday.
So which would have been in March?
Yeah, it was at Nana Akufo-Addo's birthday. Mm-hmm. They had all gathered there. I wasn't there. I wasn't at the birthday.
They had gathered in Ajay Blankson's house on Akufo-Addo's birthday.
On Akufo-Addo's birthday.
Okay. And when you say they had all gathered, who were these? At nine?
Oh, friends of Nana Akufo-Addo, okay, associates and so on, had mm-hmm. gathered at Ajay Blankson's house. And in the course of the discussions, the idea of organizing a demonstration came up.
But you said you were not there?
I wasn't in that place. I wasn't at that birthday party.
Okay.
You understand? So after the birthday party, I had a call from Ferdinand Ayim.
Oh, the late Ferdinand.
The late Ferdinand Ayim. And he said to me that, look, we've been at Akufo-Addo's party. These discussions are taking place and so on. And we think that we need to concretize it and so on. And that a meeting was being scheduled, I think, for the next day. You know, so my task from the conversations that I had with him was to bring on board people like me. I mean, obviously, we came from different backgrounds, we had different political persuasions and so on. And the idea was to have a broad-based movement. So mm-hmm. we needed to bring many other people on board and so on. So I attended the meeting and I agreed to be part.
Who were at this meeting when you attended? Where was it held?
The meeting was held in Dr. Charles Rekubrobe's house. Mm-hmm. The nine of us were there. There were other people who were there. Ferdinand Ayim was there. There were a few other people who were there. You know, the problem is that I'm telling the story of 25 years ago.
I understand, and everyone appreciates how much you can remember.
And I'm relying almost entirely on my memory.
Yeah, yeah.
I am not like Victor Newman and Kwaku Bakun who don't play with records and documents. I hardly keep documents and so on.
Okay.
So I'm relying entirely on my memory. Mm-hmm. The other difficulty is simply that too many things happened at too many different places. And no one person can tell the whole story.
Of Kumi Preko?
Nobody. There's no. Oh,
that's interesting.
Well, for all events, for all the historical events, you can only tell a part of the story.
The angle.
Because you can't be everywhere at every time.
But that means that many things were happening for Kumi Preko at different places to bring it together.
Of course.
Different people.
Every day. 1,000 things were happening, more than 1,000 things were happening every day. We were at the core of the whole movement. I mean, the nine of us were at the core of the whole movement. We were receiving reports from all over the country. We were discussing these reports and so on. Indeed, that was a period in my life when sometimes we met 3 times a day.
I see.
I mean, every morning before I went to work, you know, we would gather in Nana Akufo-Addo's.
What work were you doing at that time? Editor of the newspaper?
Well, I was doing many things. I've always done many things. Mm-hmm. Editing a newspaper, organizing agitations.
Agitations?
Of course. I mean, all my life, I've been at the center of all kinds of agitations, mm-hmm. you know. So I wake up in the morning and drive straight to Nana Akufo-Addo's house, and we would have breakfast, you know, in Nana Akufo-Addo's house and discuss the program for the day. And then in the afternoon, we would meet in Charles Rekubrobe's house and have lunch and work around lunch and so on. It became like a routine, you know. And the evening, we would gather again and visit different people, different organizations and so on, convincing them to join us, discussing their difficulties and problems and so on. And then we may end up in Ajay Blankson's house or places that he was associated with and have dinner, you know. So it was rigorous. I mean, it was a 24-hour enterprise. You know, there was no rest for anybody. And we worked so very hard, so very
hard. Towards May 11th.
And all the other things that happened.
But how did you choose May 11th? Was it spontaneous? Was it by calculation of the preparation of things you needed to do and all that?
Well, somehow, I think there was a desire to create a myth. Mm-hmm. You know, we set out to create a myth. And if you watch, all the major events that we organized were organized on Thursdays.
Okay, I have not noticed. No, so this was a Thursday.
If you check the dates.
The date, okay. Know. Okay, so this was a Thursday.
Yeah, but it was a deliberate effort to create a myth.
Why would Thursdays be mythical?
There was nothing superstitious about it, you know, but somehow we agreed that we would organize our events on Thursdays. It created a certain myth. And so,
okay, yeah, okay. You know. Yeah, so that every Thursday there was panic about what was going to happen.
It didn't happen every Thursday. I mean, sometimes there were intervals of 2 weeks and so on.
Yeah, okay.
But we made it a point to organize the major events on Thursdays and so on. So we had this first meeting, and the first meeting decided that we're going to organize this demonstration. We selected the team, which was Kumi Prekum and so on. And to be honest with you, most of our statements were crafted by Dr. Charles Rekubrobi.
When you say statements, what do you mean?
Oh, press conference statements.
Okay. So all right, most
of them were crafted by Dr. Charles.
Your public statements.
Yeah. Dr. Charles Rekubrobi. Mm-hmm. Akutuampa also played a key role in putting together statements, you know, and so on. Akutuampa is perhaps, I've worked with many people, you know, I've come to respect many people. And I have no doubt at all that of the many people that I've worked with, Akutuampa is a super brain. Mm. You know, he's a super brain. I mean, his intellectual capacity is huge, you understand. So he helped in crafting most of those statements and so on. So crafting statements and so on was virtually between him and Dr. Rekubrobi. Mm. Dr. Rekubrobi was the workhorse of the movement. I mean, he would work nonstop. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I was wondering whether he slept at all. You know, he was working all the time. Work, you know, all the time. I mean, if you have an enterprise and you have somebody like Charles with you, you can rest. He would do the work, and he did do the work, you know. There were some of us who also tried to work hard. You know, but we were more on the strategic side, you know, trying to think through things, anticipating what was likely to happen, and developing strategies for overcoming the hurdles in our way and so on. And some of us also did the legwork of moving from place to place, getting in touch with people and so on. Charles didn't do a lot of that, you know.
He didn't move around that much.
No. It was Akutuampa who managed to combine real activism with his intellectual work. Mm-hmm. You know.
What did Nana Akufo-Addo do?
That's an interesting question. I've heard many people describe him as the leader of the Alliance for Change. Maybe to some extent they're right. Okay. Because he eventually became the public face of the movement. Mm-hmm. But strictly speaking, we set out to build a strong collective, and we insisted on collective leadership. So nothing happened that did not involve everybody. Nothing happened that we all didn't agree on. Nobody gave instructions and so on. And you can talk to all of them and they would admit to this. Mm-hmm. Nana's role came up, and I mean the president, His Excellency Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo, his name came up when we had drafted the first statement which we were to use at the press conference. Mm-hmm. And then we asked ourselves, who amongst us was going to read that press statement? And I think it was Akutuampa and I who said that it has to be Nana Akufo-Addo. And there was no objection, you know. And then the question came that, yes, he's going to read the statement on our behalf, but in what capacity? Who would he be when he reads our statement and so on? And the suggestion came that we should describe him as the spokesperson. So throughout, Nana Akufo-Addo was known as the spokesperson of the group.
Of the Alliance for Change.
Of the Alliance for Change. We didn't have a chairman, we didn't have a secretary, we didn't have any position. The only position we had was the position of a spokesperson. And that was conferred on Nana Akufo-Addo simply because he read the first statement at the first press conference.
Did he read subsequent statements then? So he became the face of it?
Yeah, he became more or less the public face of the alliance, you know, and it worked.
What did Kweku Bako do, for instance?
Kweku was more or less an activist, a serious activist. I mean, even in those days, Kweku did provide us with historical material.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Way back even then.
No, Kweku has always been known for that. Anybody who has worked with Kweku Bako cannot deny the fact that when it comes to our history and when it comes to finding relevant materials which confirm the facts of our history and even sometimes the facts of our present and so on, he happens to be very good at that, and he played that role throughout. Indeed, all of us were involved in the general thinking who shaped things and so on. You know, after the Kumipeku demonstration, when four people had been shot and so on, we're all scouting around looking for information and so on. And I can say with some certainty that Kweku played a lead role in that. We eventually came to identify the people who had done the shooting.
Oh, I see.
Yes, we knew
the individuals who had shot the gun that killed.
The individuals who had fired the guns which had killed.
Oh, I see.
We came to identify the vehicles they had used. We came in possession of police wireless messages and so on.
Whoa.
You know, so we got a whole gamut of documents and so on. And to a very large extent, Kweku was at the center of that, you know. So that's the interesting.
Against the Rawlings presidency, you were able to get all that kind of information. That's
you can always get any information that you want in this country. I mean, there's no
people don't magic know much about Kweku Poku because he didn't sort of continue in the political discourse post 2000 and all that. So when I talk to people these days, they know Kwesi Pratt, they know Kweku Bako, they know Nana Akufo-Addo, Dr. Brobe, he ran for elections and all that. And he still continued to be active in radio and television conversations about freedom and all of that. Tony Akotoampao is known, Ajib Langson. Who is Kweku Poku? What did he do and where is he?
Well, Kweku Poku is an interesting chap. I mean, there are different personalities in the alliance. Mm-hmm. I mean, you take somebody like Victor Newman.
Yeah.
And I didn't hear or see Victor Newman mount a podium and make a speech. Mm-hmm. You know, Victor Newman was always a background person, you know. And Victor Newman, to some extent, is like Kweku Bako. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people don't.
In terms of being a repository of information.
Yeah, well, Victor Newman is the one who is always in the background, who would always go and fish for documents, who would write, you know, research material and pass it on and so on. And I'm not surprised that he has become the director of research in the Flagstaff House because he played that role even then. Mm-hmm. I mean, he would go around and find information and so on, never wanting to take credit for anything. Now, Kweku Poku was a very, very quiet gentleman, you know, perhaps one of the most gentle people amongst us. Very, very deep, you know, very, very deep person. But he also never played a frontline role. He preferred to be in the background, you know, and to tag along and so on. And in any serious movement, you need all of this, you know, to be able to move forward, to be able to make your impact, to be able to realize your objectives and so on. So that was Kweku Poku.
What was his profession? Was he a politician?
Well, Kweku Poku, I don't know who you call a politician, you understand? Mm. Uh-huh. I wouldn't call Kweku Poku a politician. I call Kweku Poku a citizen who feels very deeply about his country and wants to make a contribution.
Was he a lawyer?
No, Kweku Poku, as I knew him, was dabbling in music. I mean, he plays the harmonica very well. Even now, I've seen him at +2, +3.
Oh, he's still around. Yeah. Let's have the photograph of the of the nine again, and let's identify harmonica,
you know. So he dabbles in music.
So he's an artist. He's the one standing on top of Akoto Ampaw, first from left, next to you.
Yeah. Kwakubuku dabbles in music. Okay. He's an artist, you know. He works in that direction.
Okay.
You know. I think if I'm right, I think at a certain point he also was a teacher.
Okay.
I think he worked in NAFTI. You know,
Teaching in that area?
I think
teaching
so.
Television I and think f- film so, and that
if
kind
I'm
of
not
thing.
Mistaken.
Okay, he's a creative kind of guy.
He's very creative.
Okay.
Very creative. And was very key in the design of the posters that we used, you know, and so on, all the artwork and so on. He was very key in thinking through themes and so on. So what about everybody was useful.
Kakraba Cromwell, tell us a bit more about him.
Kakraba Cromwell was a student leader.
From the University of Ghana?
He was a student leader. I think he had been president of the National Union of Ghana Students. And Kakraba Cromwell came on board with some exuberance, which was needed at the time. Mm-hmm. He was very, very exuberant. He was open. He was frontal. He spoke on a number of platforms and so on. Again, there were three people in the group who used to do the legwork, you know, myself, Kakraba Cromwell to some extent, and Ajay Blankson. Mm-hmm. And if the group had to go to war, you know, we would take the lead and prepare the ground and do all the organizing and get the others to join us later. Kakraba Cromwell, for example, was very instrumental in organizing Kumasi. Mm-hmm. You know, we went ahead as the advance team with Kakraba Cromwell. We stayed in Charles Rekubrobe's family house. You know, Charles Rekubrobe is related to Victor Owusu, the late Victor Owusu, and he made his family house available to us. And Kakraba Cromwell was with us. There were other people who would hardly be mentioned who played a key part. I remember that we went to Kumasi with a gentleman called Charles Baine. Mm-hmm. And Charles Baine came from the Democratic Alliance of Ghana, working mainly in the United States of America and also in London with others. And so on. Charles Baine was with us in Kumasi doing the preparatory work for the second demonstration, which we dubbed Simi Preko and so on. And there were many people. I mean, Kumasi, for example, I mean, we had built a group in Kumasi over years.
You understand? Who is we?
Well, those of us who have been engaged in all kinds of activism. And the group in Kumasi had its roots in the Movement for Freedom and Justice, which was headed by Professor Edu Buahini. It had its group in the Dankwa Buzia Club, and it had its roots also in the Popular Party for Democracy and Development. I'm talking about people like Nana Ninsin Mbia, okay? Nana Kwating, who was the chairman of the PPDD in Kumasi, a guy called Victor Owusu, Kwabnede, who was an old activist of the Convention People's Party.
Not the one we know. Not the former NDC chairman.
No. He's much younger.
Okay.
I mean, Kwabnede is an old activist. Mm-hmm. And so Dr. Bilson.
Dr. Bilson
was key, you know, in the Ashanti region and in Kumasi and so on. There were many others, you know, who held the fort in Kumasi, you know, and they did a lot of the work in Kumasi. I mean, Kumasi was the biggest demonstration that we organized. In Accra, it was estimated that we put about 100,000 people on the streets. In Kumasi, the estimate was that we put 500,000 people on the streets of Kumasi.
Okay.
And it was thanks to the work that all of these very different people and so on who have not been recognized, who history may never recognize, who may never be known and so on, who put their shoulders to the wheel and made Kumasi happen.
So this was in 1995, and it was 1 year to the second election under the Fourth Republic, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So was a country like today that we already get into election mood? Were we in an election mood? There was no private radio, by the way.
Yeah, there was no private radio.
Joy FM had not started.
No, there was no private radio.
Okay, let me deal with that because the young people want me to ask you that question.
The first attempt at establishing private radio was the attempt which was made by Dr. Charles
Preko. And that was after Kwame Preko.
That was Radio I.
Yeah, was it after Kwame Preko?
Yes, I think so.
It was after Kwame Preko. Okay, so, the young people are interested in this, so let me ask you that. Mm-hmm. There was no private radio.
Yeah.
There was no private television.
Yeah.
There was the state broadcaster GBC, GBC Radio.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get your message across to pull 100,000 people, which was a CNN estimate, and we quoted that in our promotional video? How did you, what, who were you telling what?
You know, you have to think outside the box when you're dealing with extraordinary situations, mm-hmm. okay? So I recall that we had developed some scheme for communication, which was very irregular.
Mm-hmm.
I recall that in 1992 or thereabout, we got a stylo-styling machine.
What's that?
It's a machine for duplicating
okay.
material.
The so one newspapers use it?
No, no, no.
Okay.
This is the one you do manually.
Okay.
You
know, okay.
We used to do it manually and mm-hmm. so on. And I think that machine had come from Akutuampa. Akutuampa is the one who managed to arrange that machine. And we couldn't keep it in our houses because we were all under surveillance. You know, it was difficult to meet and so on. So again, it was Akutuampa who came up with the brilliant idea that we should plant this machine in the boys' quarters of somebody who was working for government, who was living in a government bungalow. And I will not tell you who that person is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but that person was with you?
Well, he had worked with Akutuampa and others in the okay. New Democratic Movement.
Okay, and so he was a government person?
He was working in government, okay. but he was sympathetic to our cause.
Okay, you know. So the machine was kept in his house?
So we planted this machine
when
in
his... When you say we planted, do you mean we kept it or you put it in
well,
the ground?
We put it in his boys' quarters.
Okay.
So we'll go there at night, you know, and overnight, throughout the night, we'll be printing these documents and so on. And then we found a way, which I'm not going to describe to you because it might be useful
again. Yeah. I don't think it's going to be useful again. You have mobile phones, you have Facebook, you have WhatsApp.
Oh, you never
how
know.
Is that going to be useful again? You will never need that again.
You never know.
You will never need it.
In the face of mobile phones and all, mm-hmm. there are still underground movements around the world.
Okay.
So mobile phone does not answer the question.
Okay. So you distributed these
so
somehow?
So we'll find a way of distributing this. And people just collected them and made more copies and so on.
Oh, I see.
That method was still available.
Ah.
And then we would also go to the foreign media and do things which came back to Ghana and got spread.
How did it get back to Ghana? Graphic we use it?
You know, I recall that the first person to make allegations of extrajudicial killings against the PNDC was me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, how did I do it? I went to the UK, I went to London, and granted an interview to the British Broadcasting Corporation. I was interviewed by Robin White at the time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I know.
And I made all those allegations and so on BBC. And it came straight back to Ghana because it was on Focus on Africa, and
yeah.
everybody was listening to Focus on
yeah.
Africa
yeah.
and so on. So the BBC was one of the means of reaching here. We also had somebody who was sympathetic, who was working for the Voice of America. He had worked with the Ghana Broadcasting Corporation, and I think his name was Robert Kote.
Richard Kote,
I mean, you're right.
Yeah,
you're
Richard
right.
Kote.
Richard Kote.
Yeah.
And Richard Kote would grant us interviews mm-hmm. and so on. There were still private newspapers. We still had private newspapers. And the Ashanti Pioneer played a leading role in spreading our message. And then you had the Ghanaian Voice, which was edited by Dan Ansah.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to work on the Ghanaian Voice with Dan Ansah. So the Ghanaian Voice also became an instrument of propagating our ideas. And
so you have the Statesman at that time, 95? Was it
I
there?
Think so. I think we had the Statesman. Ferdinand Ayim was working for the Statesman mm-hmm. and so on. So the print media played a key role in disseminating.
So how did people know they had to be at Kwame Nkrumah Circle at 6 o'clock in the morning?
Hold on,
yeah.
hold on. You know. Now the other thing we did was to meet people directly.
One on one.
One on one. And that was a hell of a job. I mean, look, in the evenings, we'll go to 3 wards, 3 constituencies, and meet the people face to face and deliver the message. And we did it almost every day. You know, personal direct contact with people was part of the trick.
Mm-hmm.
And then another part of the trick had to do with the circulation of pamphlets, leaflets, and so on, which were printed in large numbers and just spread them across the country and so on. You understand? Look, mind you, some of us had worked underground for a period.
Yeah.
I mean, 1985, 1986, 1987, I was in an underground movement, mm-hmm. you know.
So you knew how to get your message across.
And I think I can say that I belonged to an underground movement whose leader was Yao Opoku. Yao Opoku is a lawyer, mm-hmm. you understand. And we had learned a lot of things and so on.
Okay.
And Sheshe mm-hmm. was an expert, you know, in doing some of these things and so on. So we managed to get the message across, perhaps even more effectively than we managed to do today with all the proliferation of electronic media and so on.
It would appear so.
Yeah.
So on the night before the May, where were you? Where did you stay before you started the day early morning to conduct this demonstration?
If my memory serves me right, that night, that is the 10th of May, 1995, we must have been at the residence of Nana Dankwa Akufo-Addo.
Which one? Where he
Nima,
now lives?
Nima.
Where residence. He lives now?
I don't know where he lives.
He lives at Nima. Yeah. At least that's where he gave his president's 2016 acceptance speech.
Presidents don't live in one
No, place. not when he was president-elect. That's where he gave his acceptance speech.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay. But so you are referring to the same house?
Yeah. I mean, that was my house too. It was everybody's house.
Everyone was going there?
No, it was our house. I mean, we ate there. We did everything there, you know.
I see.
Yes.
So you stayed there the night before?
No, I didn't stay there. Mm-hmm. We met there to evaluate what we had done. And to anticipate what was likely to happen the next day, which was the D-Day, mm-hmm. and so on. And I recall giving the advice that it was important for all of us to sleep in different places, and preferably not our own homes, and so on. Because we've had the experience before, you know. I won't tell you where I slept.
Oh, you could, you can. 25 years.
No.
25 years has come and gone.
Look,
you can tell us the area. We don't need to know.
No. So many people are still alive.
Okay.
And so on.
Okay.
People did things for which they were still feel uncomfortable about talking about and so on. Okay. I don't want to drag people into the
center. So you stayed somewhere, and each of you stayed at different places.
Yes.
Do you know where Kweku Baku stayed that night?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know.
What was the plan for the morning?
So in the morning, we gathered at the Nima residence of Nana Akufo-Addo.
At what time?
Oh, very early in the morning.
Six.
Must have been at dawn, maybe before six.
Okay.
You know. And Paul, a lot of people thought that we were grandmasters. You know, we had everything and so on. It wasn't like that. In the morning when we met at Nana Akufo-Addo's house, mm-hmm. we kept asking ourselves whether we're going to be successful or not.
Oh, the morning of the event?
The morning of the event. How many people are going to turn up?
You didn't know. You had no way to be sure.
There was so much fear. We had been warned that people were going to be killed and so on.
I think I've jumped something. Oh, sorry. Let me come back to that. And viewers, let me do this. Listening to the news as a little boy in those days, there was a lot of encounter between you and the police. The GBC News kept mentioning your names to report to the police headquarters. What was that about?
The police and everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, the ACDRs had held a press conference.
Yes, they had
warned that if you went on the demonstration, people would die and so on. So there was a lot of fear-mongering.
Did you encounter the police, the nine of you, in meetings?
Yeah, I think we had had a number of meetings with the police and so on.
So they set the route because that then became the controversial
issue. We agreed on the route.
You agreed with the police on the route?
Yeah.
So this was a permitted demonstration, by the way.
Of course, we went through the
process,
motion and so on.
Yeah.
And that was not the first demonstration. We had done many demonstrations before.
Okay.
The rules of the game had been established and mm-hmm. so on, and yet we were being threatened and so on.
So we are back at Nana Akufo-Addo's house, 6 a.m. on demonstration day.
I think I probably got there before 6 a.m.
Okay.
You know. And then we all gathered in Nana's house.
Did you dress in a particular way?
I was in a Kumi Preku t-shirt.
Everybody that's what
was
people
in a Kumi
had, okay.
T-shirt, mm-hmm. you know. And I carried a lot of things, you know, because Akotiwampa and I were in charge of the security of the whole demonstration. So we carried the communication equipment. The communication equipment was carried by me in the front and Akotuampa in the back, you know.
The front of the row and the back all the way.
Akotuampa was responsible for the back.
But that's a long distance, because at some point the front was at Kingsway, the back was still at Kwame Nkrumah Circle.
Well, now it's difficult to tell which was the front and which was the back, because at some point the crowd was so huge that you couldn't tell which was the front and which was the back. But in planning for the demonstration, we had agreed that I would take care of the front and Akotuampa would take care of the back, and we had a responsibility to ensure that infiltrators did not come in to mess the demonstration up and so on.
Okay.
You know, but in Akufo-Addo's house, at some point, I think around about between 7:30 and 8.
You guys were still there, you hadn't moved.
Yeah. A decision was made that we need to go on a recce to find out what the situation was at the Kwame Nkrumah Circle. And I think it was Akotuampa and I who volunteered to go on the recce. So we walked from Nana Akufo-Addo's house towards the Kwame Nkrumah Circle.
But you could be identified. People knew who you were.
Oh, of course, of course. Okay. You always had to take a risk in those days. And my goodness, as we approached the Kwame Nkrumah Circle, what we saw was shocking.
People had massed up.
Thousands of people. Thousands and thousands of people shouting, singing. I mean, the police could not stop that demonstration. Just multitudes and so on. We were so surprised. We didn't think that we would pull that crowd, you know, but that crowd had gathered
waiting for leadership.
Yeah, so we quickly rushed back to Nana Akufo-Addo's house and gave a report about what had happened and recommended that we needed to move immediately, because if we didn't move immediately to provide leadership to that crowd, God knows what could have happened. That crowd needed to be led, you know, and so on. So we moved in. Now, we had organized the security so well, you understand? We had people who were going to protect the leaders. We put the leaders in a ring, and there were people who were going to protect the leaders. They formed a ring. We put the leaders in the ring. And then there were rows of people in front of the leaders and so on. So the leaders were embedded in the crowd, you know, in order to ensure that, you know, I was exposed. Akotuampa was exposed and so on. So if you look at the pictures of the demonstration.
If we can get some of the videos of the demonstration, just put it up so we can have a feel of 25 years ago.
And if you saw pictures of the leaders which were taken and so on, we were not there. You understand? Akotuampa was not there, and so on. So that was the strategy. But we had trained people to help protect the demonstration and to act as some kind of security.
So when the demonstration ended, or did it end, what happened? You started marching and what happened?
The demonstration did not end formally. It didn't
What end. Is this? This is at the funeral. What were you telling Nana Akufo-Addo?
This is, I think, just before the press conference.
Yeah.
You know, and the taking of that photograph, which has become historic.
Yes, but so what were you discussing here?
We used to talk about everything and anything, and I cannot remember exactly what was being discussed. But you can see Dr. Nyaho Tamakro.
Yeah.
You can see young Nana Adodankwa Akufo-Addo. And you can see, I think, Kwaku Baku in his dark glasses.
Yes, in the background. Yeah,
yeah, and some other activists who I say would never be known.
I didn't ask about Dr. Nyaho Tamakro. What was his role? You sort of mentioned other people. What was Dr. Nyaho Tamakro's role?
Well, Nyaho Tamakro was part of the group, very much a part of the group.
Mm-hmm.
He took part in all the meetings. He took part in all the decisions that were taken.
Yeah.
He brought his own expertise in security and so on. You know, he was a very key member of the group.
Yeah.
You know, yeah.
Wow.
So this is Dr. Charles Rokubrobe's house, you know.
So how did the demonstration end on that day? If we get photos of the demonstration, we'll show it. How did it end on that day?
It ended disastrously.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the first shots were fired around Farisco. That is where Ahunu Honga lost his life.
Yes.
You know.
So this is the demonstration. So is this the front or is this the back?
This must be somewhere in the middle.
Okay, VAT is like HIV, that's what somebody. Yeah. So where is it? Hold it here, hold it here, hold it here. What gate is that?
I suspect that this must be around the high street, you know. And this is not the tick of the demonstration.
Oh, those are the side issues. Those who broke away on the
what
side.
What had happened was that at Farisco, when the first shooting happened, the demonstrators broke up into all kinds of groups. Mm. There were a group which headed towards Makola, a group took the path to the Trades Union Congress, and so on. So the demonstration really didn't come to a formal end, you know. I found my way, you know, to Dr. Brovey's house, you know. And
oh, I see.
Yes.
So you didn't address the demonstrators?
No, we couldn't. There was total mayhem.
When the shooting came in.
Exactly. So we all regrouped in the house of Dr. Charles Rekou Brovey, Northridge, to evaluate what had happened. We took reports of what had happened, and we decided the next line of action, you know. It was then that we decided to identify all the people who have been injured, those who have died, those who are still in hospital, and then decided to visit them, and so on, you understand. And we started discussing the next line of action. And Paul, it's interesting. Mm-hmm. After the first demonstration in Accra, there were suggestions by some of us that we needed to continue the demonstrations, needed to take the demonstration to Kumasi. Mm-hmm. And there were others who said no, they didn't want to risk any more lives. They were so passionate that there should be no reason why anybody should die, that they didn't want to risk any more lives. So the Accra one was enough.
How many had died in Accra?
I think four.
You know. That's significant.
Yeah. And then there was another group of people who said that, look, Accra has been so hugely successful, and that if we did another demonstration somewhere else and we did not attract the same crowd and so on, it would be an anticlimax.
Yes, that's true.
And it would take from the impact of what we had done in Accra. And there was a small group of the core members who said, no way, we are continuing this to the end. You understand? Until the demands are met, we needed to continue what we had started. I think we had a long, long, long debate about this. This debate must have lasted for about 3 days or a week. You know. And
in meetings upon meetings.
Meetings upon meetings. What do we do after Kumi Preko? So eventually, if my memory serves me right, and I've already told you that...
It's a long time ago.
No one person knows everything.
Yeah.
You understand? So eventually, I think what happened was that those who insisted on carrying on then said, okay, if you don't want to come along, stay away. We are going ahead.
Oh, I see.
Yes. And then everybody came on board, and Kumasi happened. And after Kumasi, my goodness, the enthusiasm was so huge. We went everywhere. We went to all the regional capitals, you know. And Tamale was quite significant. You know, Tamale is not as big.
Who was bankrolling all that? Who was paying for this?
That is an interesting question. Hmm. I mean, in today's politics, everything must be paid for. Okay? Everything is paid for. Even by 1995, we did a lot of things on the basis of the commitment of individuals. People were not asking to be paid to do anything. Yeah. It was passion for what we were doing. It was commitment. It was the realization that, you know, we had to shape national destiny to some extent and so on. You understand? So it wasn't money. I mean, today I know that the political parties, when they are organizing demonstrations and so on, they have to put in a lot of resources. So it wasn't like that in the 1980s and early 1990s, you know. Of course, you needed money to buy placards,
yeah,
you know, to buy ink, to write the slogans and so on. But that was not the kind of huge money that, you know, we tend to spend on our politics today. And that kind of money came from well-wishers, you know, came from the activists themselves. I guess that somebody like Dr. Charles Rekubrobi put in a fortune, you know. I guess he put in a fortune. Dr. Charles Rekubrobi was an energy policy advisor, you know, I suspect from the UNDP, seconded to the government and so on. And his remuneration was quite impressive then, you know. And he spent a lot of his own personal resources on this. All of us became fundraisers, and we raised a bit of funds and so on. 2 days ago, incidentally 2 days ago, there's a friend of mine whose name I would never mention. Even if you put a gun to my head, I won't mention his name. Who sent me a message. I hope he's not watching me tonight. But he sent me a message and said, oh, you guys celebrated this event without inviting people like us who helped with some resources and so on. So I called him back and I said, I never knew that you put in a penny.
Oh, I see.
I didn't know. But he was speaking the truth. I've checked, eventually checked, and found out that this friend of mine, this very, very good friend of mine, contributed to the kitty. You understand? So it was all like that. You know, I mean, civil servants.
Two more questions as I'm coming to the end of it.
And so on.
So there was some discussions that we had as small boys that the Alliance for Change in 1996, Alliance had become very popular after the demonstrations and was almost bigger than the existing opposition political parties. There was then a very big conversation that should Alliance become a political party, because you had managed to get an amalgamation of people from different CPP, UP, and it was feared by the government because of what you had carried out in the demonstrations, that the Alliance should become a political party, or the Alliance should back a certain political candidate. And the discussions and the conversations and the tensions that it brought up resulted in the defeat of the opposition in 1996 election, because from what you guys did by 1995, J.J. Rawlings was gone. But you couldn't consolidate what the Alliance did, and that's what occasioned Mr. Rawlings's victory in 1996. And so for some of you, the Alliance leaders who saw what had happened, you were certain that the 2000 election would be won by the opposition. What is the truth in this Alliance becoming? I'm sure this is the first time you're speaking about it, and we are grateful that you're speaking about it on our platform.
Well, there is some truth in it, and only some truth in it. That agitation had actually begun before the Alliance for Change was established. Okay. I recall that when we formed the Movement for Freedom and Justice, at some point at a meeting in the house of Professor Albert Edubuahene, who was the national chairman of the Movement for Freedom and Justice, he came up with a suggestion that we should turn the movement into a political party. And there was a lot of pressure on us to transform the Movement for Freedom and Justice into a political party which united the opposition against government. And we could not reach agreement on that. I mean, I opposed it. I vehemently opposed it, you know, and said, look, I'm an Nkrumahist. No matter what happens, I'm an Nkrumahist. And we are fighting for pluralism. We are fighting for free expression and so on. You cannot have free expression and pluralism and so on if all of us are headed into one political movement, you know. And there are many others who opposed that idea at the time.
So about the AFC, what happened?
Now, that same pressure came up again when we formed the Alliance for Change. There were many, many, many people who came to us and said we should transform the Alliance for Change into a political party, but we resisted it. You know, we decided not to form a political party, not to transform the Alliance for Change into a political party. As a matter of fact, at some stage, we even decided, in the initial stages, we decided that none of us was going to contest for the presidency or for office in the political parties, and so we took that decision, firm decision. And then we also decided not to support any of the presidential aspirants. So we saw our role as just carrying on the agitation to free space, you know, for everybody, and not to put ourselves, you know, in power, or to use that as a process for grabbing political power, you understand? Now, some interesting things happened, and I don't know, you know. One of the biggest opposition to the Alliance for Change came from the New Patriotic Party.
I don't understand that.
You wouldn't.
That came from them how?
Yeah.
Because they are Nana Akufo-Addo, they are Charles Reco Brobe, they are Victor Newman, were part of the Alliance for Change.
Yeah, you wouldn't understand. Let me explain it to you.
Okay.
The Alliance for Change had become so big, so influential, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And there were fears from the established political parties that if we transformed into a political party, it would affect their fortunes.
You will overrun them completely.
Exactly. So yeah. That fear was there.
Yeah, it's a genuine fear.
Yeah. There was also the fear that having galvanized these millions, you know, across the country and so on, leaders of the Alliance for Change had become so strong, so influential, so powerful.
Very popular.
That they could get into the political parties and take over the leadership of the political parties.
And win, yes.
Yeah. So, from the New Patriotic Party, a newspaper was established. It was called The New Era.
Mm-hmm.
You should check on that.
Mm-hmm.
And the sole purpose of The New Era was to fight the Alliance for Change. You know. So, the Rawlings regime was fighting us all right. But amongst us, in the opposition, there were forces which were also fighting against us. Every publication of The New Era was directed not at the Rawlings regime, but at the Alliance for Change. We were called all kinds of names. We were called usurpers and so on.
Including their own people, the MPP's people that I've named, Nana Akufo-Addo.
Nana Akufo-Addo was seen then, was seen then as a rival, as a threat to some entrenched forces within the New Patriotic Party.
You are referring then straight away to the J. Akufo people?
No.
Because Professor Du Bois was exiting at that time.
No.
And the new leadership...
As a matter of fact, the new era was established by Professor Du Bois. It was printed from Professor Du Bois's house.
But in 1995, Du Bois was exiting, wasn't he?
Take it from me.
Okay.
The new era was sponsored...
Yeah, I get that. So maybe Professor Du Bois might have felt that having led the culture of silence, breaking the culture of silence, and having led that movement, maybe he probably felt, I mean, in pure political science analysis, he probably felt that his place had been taken by other people.
Look,
so that it was not a policy of the New Patriotic Party, it was a sort of territorialism.
If you want to put it that way, I'm not going to object to that, you know. But you need to understand something. Both Professor Edu Buahiri and Nana Akufo-Addo had been active in the People's Movement for Freedom and Justice, which was led by Kobna Agbelegbedema and General Afrifa.
But that was 20 years earlier.
That was 1979, thereabout.
Oh, yeah, about 17 years earlier.
You know, okay. Thereabout, And indeed, Nana Akufo-Addo had become the national secretary of the People's Movement for Freedom and Justice.
But Dr. Bedamo Asamoah says they were joint secretaries. He and Nana Akufo-Addo were joint secretaries.
But Nana Akufo-Addo was secretary.
Yes, okay, yes.
Be that as it may.
Mm-hmm.
And then, when the ban on party political activities was lifted, Nana Akufo-Addo was very, very, very close to Professor Du Bois.
Yes.
I mean, he was so close. He actively supported Professor Du Bois.
Mm-hmm.
But when Kumi Preko came, when the Alliance for Change came, even his friends began to see him as a threat. Mm-hmm. You know, all of us were seen as threats and so on. And that led to that battle which was waged against us from some quarters within the New Patriotic Party.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
That's an interesting bit of history that we have to document and study. Mm-hmm. Michael Kwe has not written about that yet. Okay, another
Michael
question.
Kwe was not involved in this struggle.
Yeah, I know. I know that.
He was not involved in this.
I mean, you want to,
I can say that Michael emphatically. Was he was not involved in this.
Another matter is that what was the relationship between this alliance going forward? Was there a sort of leadership, frosty relationship between Charles Rekobrobe and Nana Akufo-Addo in the Alliance for Change?
Look, I wouldn't put it that way. For every movement, for every aggregation of human beings and so on, there are tensions, there are frictions, there are misunderstandings and so on, especially for a broad national alliance such as the Alliance for Change. Mm-hmm. You understand? I mean, I considered myself as an unrepentant Nkrumahist. Mm-hmm. You understand? And there were people in the group who also possibly considered themselves as unrepentant Dankwa Buziaists and so on. So we always had to make concessions. We always had to, and so on, you know. So there were tensions right from day one. You know, eventually the Alliance for Change split up into two groups.
Who led both groups?
Well, I think that the principle of collective leadership continued to guide our activities even when the breakup came. And when we broke up, some of us, maybe I shouldn't even mention the names and so on, but some of us actually broke away. I mean, Rekobrobe was prominent in the group which broke away and so on. And they claimed that they were the real Alliance for Change. Mm-hmm. And our group, which included the Nana Akufo-Addo, also claimed that it was a real Alliance for Change. Now, we did some things, you know. We immediately decided now to recruit others to join us, you know. So it was at that point that Stanley A.J. Blankson, in whose house all of this started, joined us in the core.
Joined your side?
In the core.
Okay.
You know, became a full member of the core. Mm-hmm. It was at this stage also that Hawa Yakubu was brought in into the core. Hawa Yakubu was brought into the core, the late Hawa Yakubu. Mm-hmm.
Who was an independent member of parliament.
Who was an independent member of parliament, but came into the core. Very popular, articulate woman came into the core. Mm-hmm. And then I think Achulowo, another member of parliament also joined us. I think so. I think Achulowo also joined us and became part of the core, you understand. So all of this development happened. But Paul, I would not hold what happened against anybody. You understand? Mm-hmm. I would not hold it against anybody. These are the way things ought to be. Look, we are not cattle. We are human beings. We can always not be headed in one direction. People have a right to disagree. People have preferences and so on. That is what we fought for. We fought for difference. You understand? We fought so that people could express different views. We fought and made sacrifices to build a society in which people with different views were not considered as enemies and so on. That's what we sought to build. So if amongst ourselves we could not countenance difference and so on, that would have been terrible.
Who organized the meeting that celebrated last week, 25 years ago? Was it this week? That's had you and the president and Kweku Bako and others together?
I'm not sure.
How did you get invited?
Well, I got invited by Stanley A.J. Blankson, who called me to his house and we had conversations. And he indicated to me that it would be a good idea to do something like that. First of all, I skipped one point.
Yeah.
On the day, May 11th, mm-hmm. I called Stanley A.J. Blankson and, you know, reminded him that that was the anniversary. I said, oh, is that true? And so on. Apparently, he had forgotten. Mm-hmm. So he then insisted that I come to his house. And I went to his house. We had a conversation. And he indicated that he was going to put together something like this and asked me if I thought it was a good idea. And I said, yes, it would be a good idea. Subsequently, I had a phone call. I had a text message and a phone call from Victor Newman, who indicated that something like this was going to happen. And I called Kweku Bako.
Oh, you called Kweku Bako?
I called Kweku Bako and told him that, yeah, this is what I'm hearing and so on. And he felt that it was a good idea. I've seen some publications making heavy weather about the fact that some people were not present and so on.
I was going to ask you about Nyaho Tamaklo, for instance.
I recall that when I called Kwaku Bakum, he asked me who and who were going to be there, and I said, I didn't know. And he said, it is important for all of us to be there, for everybody to be there, you understand? And I agreed with him. And I told him to get in touch with Ajib Blankson and to make that point and so on. On the day of the dinner, I noticed that some people were not there. And I asked specifically about Dr. Charles Rekubrobi. And I was informed that he's not been feeling very well now. And that he's not able to drive at night. And he didn't have a driver. And I said, look, somebody should have told me. I would have driven to his house.
And picked him up,
And picked him up, you know. Or we could have arranged for an Uber or something to bring him and so on. It was too late. I think we also asked about Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo, and somehow he had not been reached. You know, he was not reached. So we agreed that it was necessary for us to meet again with Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo. All of us agreed, including the president, agreed that it was important to gather again with Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo. Because you can't take Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo out of the group.
So this meeting was there. Why did you hold this meeting, the one that the photographs came out? Where did you hold it?
I see your promo said that it was in the Flagstaff House.
Yes.
It was not in the Flagstaff House. It was in a private residence.
Okay.
You know,
okay.
Private residence.
So what did you people talk about? What did the president say?
Paul.
Yes.
What do you think of me?
No, those that you can tell us. Of course, the one you can tell us. Throughout this conversation, you have agreed not to tell us some things. We
I mean, people invite you to a private dinner, and then you come and sit on television and be talking about what people say.
Okay, no problem.
I think you must have a very low opinion of me.
No. Sorry. Nothing in that regard. You said you called Kwaku Bakum, and that would surprise some people because there's general feeling that yourself and Kwaku Bakum are not as good as you used to be.
Who told you that?
I said there's general feeling.
Where did you get that feeling
from? People feel that.
Which people?
What's the fact?
Which people?
What's the fact, Chris? Because you said you called him, and I'm sure many will be delighted to hear that you said you called him and spoke to him. What's the general?
You're talking about people thinking or saying that there's... Which people?
So there's no problem?
I've never had a problem with anybody.
But is your relationship with Kwaku Bakum as it used to be from the 70s, 80s,
We used 90s? To sleep in the same room. We no longer sleep in the same room. I'm married. I have children.
He's married.
I have a wife. He's married. He has children.
Yeah.
We cannot be sleeping in the same room. Is that a problem for you?
Do you visit him as regularly as you were seen together all the time in those days?
Paul.
Yes, sir.
Do you visit all the people you have known in your life?
No, not anymore. I don't have time.
The people you used to visit 20 years ago, do you visit them still?
Some of them. Not all of them.
So why are you asking this question?
Because I want to know whether you
think that we are not human?
No,
we are human.
I want to know whether you still have the same relationship with him.
Well, I don't have any problem with him.
Okay.
I don't have any problem with him.
Are you concerned that Dr. Nyaho
I disagree with him on some issues.
Okay.
And it's obvious. Everybody who listens to me knows that I disagree with him.
I think
not just him.
Yeah, that's clear.
I disagree with the president sometimes.
Yes, yes.
You understand?
The fact that you called him is good enough.
Yeah.
Are you...
Sometimes I disagree with you. In fact, most times I disagree with you. Does that mean that I hate you?
In fact, all the time you disagree with me. One more question. Are you also concerned about the fact that Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo has made himself out as a major critic of Akufo-Addo? I go to Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo's house because I like to listen to him. And he's a big brain and he has a lot of experience and expertise. And I like his house. So I like to go there to listen to him. But he's been a major critic of Akufo-Addo. And for those of you who work together closely, does it unnerve you one way or the other?
Why should it?
That a former... close associates, same political party, run campaigns together. Nana Akufo-Addo becomes a presidential candidate in 2016, and Dr. Tamaklo is dead on against Nana Akufo-Addo's candidature. And Nana Akufo-Addo becomes president, and he's big against Nana Akufo-Addo's candidature.
Paul, why don't you look at the flip side? Under the leadership of Nana Adodankwa Akufo-Addo, Dr. Nyaho Tamaklo, founding member of the New Patriotic Party, close friend of Nana Akufo-Addo and so on, has been suspended from the party. Have you looked at that side too?
I thought he had been recalled.
When? So there are two sides to everything.
Yeah.
Besides, Dr. Nyahonyahuta Makro is not a small boy.
No, at all. Of course not.
You know, he's a person who has demonstrated over the years that he cares about this country as much as I do and as much as you do, and so on. He's entitled to have a different point of view. He's entitled to criticize anybody he wants to criticize, for as long as he's not engaged in sedition. You understand? For as long as he's not committing a criminal act. Why did we fight? Why did we suffer all the indignities that we suffered? I saw your promotional video.
Yeah.
There was one part of it that I was speaking, and so you know where I was speaking?
Public tribunal.
Public tribunal.
Many people have asked me that. Many people have asked me that.
I was speaking at the public
tribunal. You were on trial with Professor Dubois.
I was on trial.
With Professor Dubois.
Exactly. I was on trial with Professor Dubois. You understand? I went on trial at the public tribunal, could have faced all the consequences that people who went to the public tribunal faced, and so on. And what was it about? It was so that we can be different, so that we can speak our mind. It was so that I can disagree even with my friends.
I have to say, Sipa, that you are very, very brave. Because when I got that video, and I got it from GBC, I was trying to gather material for my films on history of Ghana, and I saw that. That day, you could have been killed. And no one would have known. No one would have cared. You were very brave. And I've always been looking for the opportunity to congratulate you for that. You were speaking to the public tribunal that had all the powers in the world, and you were accusing them of bias. Even Professor Dubois, he couldn't do that, because I heard his speech too, and he was measured. But you could have been killed that day.
You know?
Yeah. This was 1980-something.
This was 1993, I think.
93.
Okay. Before Kumi Preko.
Yes.
You understand. And I'll tell you a few things. I was arrested, you know, and Professor Dubois was arrested. He was teaching in Legon when he was arrested. So we all ended up at the police headquarters. And from the police headquarters, they took us to the National Public Tribunal. You understand? Professor Dubois had a team of lawyers.
Yes, I saw that in the video. Yes.
I decided to defend myself.
Yes, they said that too.
I was not going to have any lawyer. And I made that decision because I'd come to the conclusion that what was happening in the tribunal was political. It was not legal. And if it was political, nobody could defend me better than I could defend myself. Indeed, President Kufuor,
He was there.
Yes.
I saw him in the video.
Former President Kufuor offered to be my lawyer. And I said, well, far, no, I'll defend myself. He then said, if you don't want me as your lawyer, I would be your legal advisor. So if you look at my trial, President Kufuor was sitting right behind me.
I saw that. I'll show that video to viewers next week. I'll show it. Yeah.
President Kufuor was sitting right behind me, you know. But, hey, you know.
Was it bravery or was it just indiscretion? When you look at that today,
I don't know what it was.
Would you do the same thing? Would you risk your life? Because this guy could have said, look, take this guy and go and execute him. Just throw him somewhere.
Well, I don't know what I would do today.
There were no cameras. There was no general public. The material that I'm looking at today has been made available by GBC years after it happened. It wasn't made available then.
You know, I don't know what I would do today. And in those days, I didn't set out to do the things that I did, you know. One aspect of that trial, which still, you know, we were granted bail. I've forgotten what the amount was and so on. So we're taken into the registry. And then Auntie Mary and so on, they came together, brought deeds of properties. And then Professor Dubois had fulfilled his bail conditions and are sitting there. And they were leaving. And Auntie Mary turned to me and said, but what are you doing? Are you not going? I said, look, I don't have any property. You understand? I don't have anything to guarantee my bail. So we'll meet at the next court date. The next tribunal date. And then Auntie Mary turned to Professor Dubois and said, Edu, you can't leave Kwesi here. If you leave Kwesi here, you are finished. You know. So they came back. They went and organized some deeds on properties and so on. I had no hand in it. And they used their properties to secure my bail. So I walk out of the tribunal building Professor Dubois gets into his car. I think there was a 3 or 4 car convoy, and he's driven away. Now, I get out. I didn't have a car. I had a car then. I bought a Fiat 127 from Ben Efson, but it wasn't available.
Oh, you bought it from Ben Efson?
Yeah, I bought that car from Ben Efson. A Fiat.
Good evening to you, Big Ben.
You know. But I didn't have the car with me then, mm-hmm. You know. So I came out, and I was going to look for a taxi, you know, to go wherever I had to go. And so,
were you married?
I was married. I had children. I guess I had all my children by then.
And how did you explain these behaviors to your family?
Don't worry. Forget about that. You know.
Okay.
But then, Paul.
Yeah.
So I came out, and by the time I realized, I was flying on the shoulders of a multitude.
Oh, they lifted you up.
And they carried me from Parliament House today.
Yes, yes.
Which was then the
public tribunal.
Public tribunal.
So where Sharaj sits.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And carried me all the way to the NPP headquarters. The crowd, you know. By that time, Professor Dubois-Ahene and his wife and so on had gone into their car and had gone home.
They didn't go to the NPP headquarters?
No.
Okay.
So the crowd carried me to the NPP headquarters, and I was about to address the crowd when some of the NPP leaders came and said, no, you can't do that. You have to wait for Professor Dubois-Ahene. So they brought Professor Dubois-Ahene to join me in addressing the crowd. You know?
Wow.
But this is history, I mean.
This is a lot of history. This is a lot of history.
History, yeah.
So the final question, we ran out of time. The conditions that made all of you do Kumi Prekun, are they present in Ghana today? Is Ghana better? Would we have no basis to organize a Kumi Prekun? Or would we have basis to organize a Kumi Prekun, in which case we would have failed as a nation?
I suspect that this is a trick question, but I'll deal with it.
Mm.
You understand? Mm. The conditions of neocolonialism, the conditions in which we do not control our resources, and our resources are not exploited for the benefit of our people. The conditions in which we are not masters of our own destiny, the conditions in which foreign powers, to a very large extent, dictate who we are and what we will become, are still present today. Our neo-colonial status has not changed one bit. And all the things that we suffer, the unemployment, the low wages, frequent increases in prices of petroleum products and so on, the fact that we are getting less than 3% of the total revenue that comes from our gold and so on. All of these conditions are conditions of underdevelopment imposed on us by the colonial structure of our economy and so on. We cannot get out of this unless and until we make a conscious effort to break the chains of colonialism. That's the only way. You understand? That's the only way. We struggled against the introduction of VAT. We struggled against high cost of living and so on. We were struggling against symptoms of the problem. I would admit, we struggled against symptoms of the problem. The real problem of underdevelopment and poverty and so on are the direct result of the maintenance of the colonial structure of our economy, the maintenance of colonial politics and so on. It is not yet Uhuru in Ghana and not yet Uhuru in many, many of the African states, if not all of the African states.
So a Ghana beyond aid.
What does that mean?
Okay, I don't have much time. Let's leave it here.
Oh, tell me what that means.
That was what Akufo-Addo said in his first sessional address.
So what does that mean?
A Ghana beyond aid.
What does it mean?
Ghana beyond
aid. In real concrete terms, what does that mean?
I'll leave it here, Kwesi, but congratulations to all of you who have blazed the trail this way. God bless all of you, the leaders and the participants of that famous Kumi Prekun march, and also the government of the NDC, who agreed to call down the VAT at that time. Dr. Kwesi Bucho and others. But Ghana has had such great history with such great political competition. Even then, and one thing that worries me all the time is when I hear the political insults today. Because when I started this journey, there were no insults among politicians. It was just a competition of ideas. Even Kumi Preku that you talk about, the shooting was the first that people really complained about. One of the things that gave ETMS a bad name in those days was about that. But you guys conducted your politics with such candor, and there was not insults across the table. Today, we have a lot of that, and hopefully we'll get over
and
that
again.
And
that is why, Paul, that is why all of us must make a clear, genuine commitment to ensuring that what happened at Ayawaso West Wagon doesn't happen again.
Ever again.
That's a serious blot on our record. You understand?
Yeah.
We could not have been abhorred by the Kumi Preku killings and uphold what happened at Ayawaso West Wagon.
That's a matter of fact. I have to leave it here. We've been running for 2 hours now. It's 11 o'clock. And guess who is still in the studio? Rocky Dawuni is still in the studio. Thank you very much, Rocky, for staying here with us. And because of that, let's wrap this up. Kwesi, thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
This is a program we'll have to show again sometime. But good night, viewers. Today is Thursday, so you can chew on that. This program will be back repeated tomorrow afternoon. Those of you who fell asleep and are now waking up, you can see it at 1 o'clock. And you can see it on our Facebook page on Video On Demand. Champion, we shall win. Let the spiritual war begin. Once again, Rocky Dawuni.
Be you until you know it's you, my friend. My friend. When the humble pop your bubble, they don't ever see it come. They tumble to the magic of the word and the sound forever. I believe now they come around and asking, who that? Tell them it's the children of Judah. Breaker of a chain and the ruler. Everybody's praying. Everybody sing it, everybody say yeah.